Welcome. My name is Kasim Afzal. As usual, we will be discussing issues that are common to us all. International affairs, local issues. And what has been hot on the agenda in the last few weeks has been obviously the issue of Iraq, terrorism, and the United Nations meeting which took place in New York. 191 countries met there to come to some form of agreement. Bob Geldof wasn't too happy of the outcome since poverty was left at the bottom of the ladder. The issues that we're going to look at today are related to terminology, what the Times says about women and how it's been translated by scholars in the Quran. We're going to be looking at terminology in relation to incitement, which Tony Blair has been pushing at the United Nations. Before we move on to that, I'd like to first introduce you to my panel of guests today. On my left-hand side is Laman Ball. Laman is an IT consultant. On the left to Laman is Sadiq Hamid. Sadiq works with youth and is also a journalist. And on the far left is Sister Rubina Akhtar. Sister Rubina works in the training sector, the educational world. So first to move forward, I'm going to open up the questions now to my panel. And even though we are going to digress slightly from the main issues, I would like to first of all start on what MCB has been criticised for by a number of Muslims across Britain, and that is, are they the true voice and the true representatives of the Muslims in Britain? So the question is, who are the leaders in relation to what's been going on in the United Nations with terrorism and what's happening in Iraq? And consultation is going to take place, and which is currently taking place. So if I can first move over to my first guest, Mr. Laman. So, Mr. Laman, who are the leaders? Are MCB our leaders? Who elected them?
Well, it's an interesting question because I remember writing to the Boston Congress some years ago on this subject. We sent me initially back a motion explaining why the MCB was formed as well from you and things. And he said, in the brochure it said that the Muslims of the country, there was a big statement that said the Muslims of the country need an organization which better represented them. My argument with him was that since MCB is a kind of club of women and cigar, and there's no direct proportionality to the Muslim population, it's more of a special interest group that's not actually representative. And he agreed, and he said, we don't claim to be representative. So
they have said, are they under programs that, you know, they have about 400 organizations that are a member of MCB. Again, I know representative with other people, but they do not claim to be representative. And that's because they patently do not connect their decisions to the totality of the population. It's the activists and the community and the organizations that get together and want to join. So there is this issue of you know, how are Muslims supposed to be representative? Do they feel that they are being represented well by MCB? And to be honest, I, just as an individual Muslim, they have never come to me to ask my opinion about anything. And as far as I know, they've never done anything.
They all come to you. I mean, we're one out of the community.
Or you're one out of
us done any survey of our local community or anything like this.
So if I can pose that question to Mr. Sadiq, I mean, has MCB ever come to you? I mean, have they randomly rang up Muslims across Britain and said, this is our opinion and I've got consensus on it? I mean, surely they must be representing the Muslims in Britain, since they're on nearly every media program you look at, and Mr. Sakran is always there putting across his views or the Muslims' views.
I think, to be fair to the MCB, the aims of the MCB are very laudable and commendable. As Muslims, we do need representation at different levels, and I think they've done a pretty fair job really at that. However, I think a lot of people, Muslims in the grassroots, have voiced a number of concerns. One is about the representativeness of the MCB, and that they see it as dominated by a certain group of Muslims from certain organisations, pointing out the fact that the leadership has revolved around the same people since its inception. The other criticism is that it's too London-based. Rarely see any MCB meetings or events outside of the London area, and even though they claim that almost 400 plus organisations. Where are these organisations? Where are the representatives from these organisations? What are they doing outside of London? I mean, I know a lot of people say, well, we don't see the MCB around here, and that's supposed what demand's getting at. I mean, they say that they don't claim to be the voice of Muslims, but you get mixed messages sometimes when you hear different spokespeople from the organisation. And I think the other point I'd like to make about MCB, I think there's a tendency to think that they are the only voice when it comes to the general mainstream. The average English person, if they switch on, they might think that the MCB is the voice because they've compared themselves to the Jewish Board of Deputies. They follow that model. But what we have to remember that the Muslim community is very diverse, and there are other voices that need to be heard, and they should be given space as well.
You use the word English people. I would find this very difficult to comprehend because, I mean, I'm English, I'm British, I'm born here.
That's the man, I would say he's English or even he's got a French connection.
The common usage there, when you're talking about English and British, I mean, there's been an ongoing debate now in terms of identity, where Britain going. English is normally used in terms of ethnicity with reference to white Caucasian ethnicity, whereas Britishness is more of an inclusive term. I don't think
you can call your English
program are British as well.
There's a difference between being British and English though.
So do you not feel that you're segregating between them, England, Scotland, Wales? I mean,
that's the point I just made, Kasim. There's a difference between being English, yes, being ethnically English, being white, you're Caucasian, and being British. Do you not see that?
I do see it, yes. But if Muslim Council Britain, Sister Rabina, was not there, then who would have filled the airways? I mean, with issues that are really at the heart or the core of the Muslims today in Britain. I mean, who would replace the Muslim Council Britain? I mean, first of all, do you think like the two speakers before, or do you think different from them? Are they representative of the Muslim people?
Yes.
Do we need them, or do we need a different type of leadership in Britain that can represent British Muslims?
I think as a Muslim who has actually been brought up in Britain, I've been here for the last 29 years in Britain. I spent most of my life here. My formative education has been obtained in this country. And looking at the various faith communities, for example, the Jewish community, the Muslim community can soon learn very valuable lessons. As a faith community, we need to look around and see what lessons we can learn from other communities. Muslims are still disjointed. They are still very much disunited. And if there are groups or bodies like MCB who have actually come forward, they're actually representing a body of Muslims. As Sadiq mentioned, they should be applauded for the efforts that they're certainly making. And I certainly can actually identify with MCB as actually representing at least some sections of the Muslim community. So far, Muslims, they've not actually actively participated in politics, educational bodies, or really any official political platforms as such. We get a few odd, individuals, for example, within the parliament, Lord Nazir and a few others, which is good, but they obviously again representing a very small 0.0% of the Muslim community. And I think Muslims need to actively engage in all types of institutions, academic, political, social, at every level. And every issue affects the Muslim community, whether it's the issue of child abuse, issue of environment, it affects a Muslim, it's a human issue. What do you define as a Muslim issue? Is it the fact that we want halal food, we want to wear hijab? Mm. What do you define as a Muslim issue?
Well, I mean, I would say that religion aside, yes, whatever takes place in Britain or around the world, maybe legislative or not, or moving towards that, affects all people.
Exactly.
But as a Muslim community who's British and very diverse, would you not say that we would need, I would say, without being derogative, credible, democratic, political representation? And you touched on that. I mean, if I can just come over to Mr. Lamman here. I mean, do you not think that there should be political representation of British Muslims in Britain rather than putting all the eggs into a particular organisation? In this case, we're discussing Muslim Council of Britain.
I mean, there's a number of ways we could do it. I mean, if you want a purely representative body that the government can talk to on behalf of Muslim and have a legitimate role in discussions, which is what they tried to get it set up as, someone to talk to, right? It was largely legitimate in that process. You could have a system whereby you have a sort of a council which is basically deliberately designed to be just for Muslims who would be representative. You have to discuss the mechanism. And it could be anything from sort of a random selection of 100 Muslims and put them in the body and say, okay, choose someone.
But how did you choose these 100 people? I mean, one of the questions that arose from the meeting that Tony Blair had after what happened in London was that these people that we have today are representative of the Muslim community. And I remember very clearly that young Muslims, individuals and organisations said, well, they are not representative of us. And if I can look at, there's an article here, which is in the Times by Rushdie, and I mean, he actually mocks Muslim, it says, leaders of the Muslim Council of Britain can be relegated to the fringes where they belong. I mean, it's quite a bold statement to make. Sadiq, maybe you want to come in on this.
I think Rushdie has his own agenda, and I think he's irrelevant anyway, but the point is, talking about representation of Muslim, the views of Muslim community, there's many different ways you can do it. What I would suggest is that we actually, it isn't very difficult to find out where the voices are. We have a number of organisations, and I think it's about certainly the government and the media opening up their eyes and tuning their ears out to a greater frequency of voices.
For example, the media has brought a lot of people on.
Well, I mean, recently we started to see on the mainstream, we see impact.
If I can just comment on this particular news, impact. I mean, Sister Rubina mentioned as well that reference to politics. Mm. Now, impact have been very vocal about Muslims being involved in politics.
Yes.
Whilst there are other organisations, because you've all made reference to organisations which are doing some sort of conducive work. But then on the other side, you have other organisations like Al-Muhajirun and Hizb Tahrir, who say that to actually get involved in Western politics is forbidden. Mm. Now, they're both Muslims, so where do you draw the line? How do you move forward? Is there a relationship between that or not? Or are they totally worlds apart?
Well, I think, going back to my earlier point, the fact is we have to remember the reality of the demographics in Britain. Muslims in Britain are spread across a number of ethnic, national, linguistic, political divides, and one organisation trying to represent all of them is not going to happen, and neither is it necessary. I think diversity is healthy. What we're seeing at the moment is one organisation dominating, it's got a hegemony over representation, and the problems with that in that, and this is one of the criticisms labelled at the MCB, in that it's too close to the Labour government, because the Labour government assisted it.
What evidence is there that they're too close? That's your opinion.
Well, the fact is, you only need to look at the history of the positions that the MCB has taken. I mean, the last election, it actually overtly recommended Muslims to vote for the Labour government.
But do you think that could
And that is really compromises their identity. I mean, at the same
if
time,
you're a voice of the Muslim people, then how do you not know that this is the census that they picked up from the Muslim community, that we are behind you? Well, even though most of Britain was against the Labour government because of the war,
exactly.
Yet MCB felt they could put a positive message out.
Well, exactly. The point is, you said that most of the people were against the war, and by extension, even those hardcore Labour supporters were disillusioned with it. One only needs to go out into the communities to find out the spectrum of views and how people, took had different opinions. A lot of people supported the Lib Dems. A lot of people supported the Respect Party. To find out, you need to go out into the streets, you need to go out to the communities. There's a world outside London.
There's a world outside London. We're going to have a short break and we'll be back in a few minutes after this.
Engines room champagne. Don't forget party wheels. Dida's Eve evening wheels. and casual wears. Angie's Home Shopping Kepler Consulting can you visit KGA www.angieshomeshopping.com or call KGA 020-89-65-99-98.
Hello, welcome back. We're going to move straight into our third speaker here, our third guest, should I say, Sister Rubina. I think you wanted to come in once Mr. Sadiq was speaking.
Yes, I think just going back to the issue of MCB representing the Muslims, I think first of all, within the Muslim community, there isn't a coherent group to represent the various Muslim voices. We have fringe groups, but I think at the same time, if you want true representation of the Muslim community, there has to be representation of women as well.
Absolutely.
Women perform they are significant, or at least more than 50% of the community.
Sister Abina, have we seen any sisters at the top? Can we see how many of the leadership have women coming on and talking about?
No, I mean, groups, I have seen any significant women representation for that matter. For any groups, not just MCB. And I think MCB are performing a service to the Muslim community. On behalf of the Muslim community, it is not.
Even though they're not representative of women, as you
know, they're not representing women, and also they're not representing various other groups within the Muslim community.
Yeah. Can I just stick to the word women for a moment? I know the man wants to come in, but if you, as a woman, 50% of on average of the population, right? You yourself have said they are not representing the women, but yet they are claiming that they represent a certain section of Muslims.
Yes.
Does that mean to say that they are only representing Muslim men?
I think it's not just Muslim men, they're actually representing certain political voices within the Muslim community. And certainly those voices from the political section of the community are dominant and representative of the male section of the community, which is good and which is very well. But I think at the same time, women have a very positive role and a constructive role to play within the community, bearing in mind that more than 60% of the Muslim community are under the age of 25. I think based upon that Muslim women are the primary carers of the children.
Yeah, yeah.
They need to have more stronger voice and representation within the Muslim community, especially at the political level. It is very, very important. And they're certainly not represented. When it comes to social issues, women need to have a more stronger voice. They need to be consulted. Not just women like myself who are professional, have careers, but even the women who are talking with the children. They're preparing the future of the Muslim community.
That's right.
They should be represented.
Yeah.
And these are programs.
So women should be represented, as I'm very grateful that you're here with us today.
Yes.
I mean, Leman, you're waiting to come in. If I could just bring Leman in.
I mean, the suggestion I had just briefly mentioned, and I'll sort of flesh out a little bit. What you could do is you set up a government-sponsored body, even, that basically is very simple, and you just take the electoral register of all Muslims, maybe make a slightly different register, and just pick randomly a set of people off that register that will have a fair proportion, statistically, of women.
Yeah.
Of all the professions and so on, and this can be a body which can be charged with deciding some crucial issues about the structure of an organized Muslim community, and it would be perfectly representative. And it's a nice way of doing things. It's not like Parliament, for example, which is stuffed full of lawyers, which just is very nice for the lawyer profession because they just legislate to help the lawyers. But to have a purely representative body, it's a bit like jury service. You want to
I'm just going to say it's like jury service, yes.
And that you just pick, I mean, okay, if people can't turn up, they can't turn up, you just pick another random person until you get a full body.
And then they start losing it, because would you not want people with certain skills that could facilitate that particular body?
It depends what you're doing. I mean, you have to have some kind of process when it's just degrading into some anarchy. But basically, if you just give them a simple lecture in your decision process and some sort of rules which can organize the community, then you can do it. It was a similar situation was suggested by a chap called Bakhtar Ibrahim, who was the UN Special Representative to Iraq, whereby to get legitimacy in Iraq, and I think it would have worked, but they didn't, just to make an assembly of 1,500 Iraqis, from randomly selected using the ration cards, from the population, and use that and say, now you decide on the process for developing constitution. If that was truly done, it's a truly representative, no one can fudge it, right? And a random, you know, lottery techniques are very easy to demonstrate on fair if you want to do it. You have a truly representative body. No political interests have bribed them. Okay, maybe once they're there, they can be done. But like a jury, you keep them, put them in a hotel. hotel, they can make a decision and then get them out. And there's no chance for bribery before that. So you can't isolate them after it, well, job done. And that would potentially give a great deal of legitimacy within the Muslim community to you know, a body. But then, of course, Muslims will want that more qualified people will get better positions and other some sort of level. But the broad decision of the mechanism by which you employ people and bring them up through the ranks into positions of leadership should not be purely by kind of political interest and these kind of manipulations. It should be a properly representative journey of the people.
But we live in a democracy. I mean, what does Bush and Blair want? They want to spread democracy into other parts of the world, maybe their own type of democracy. But yet, you're saying here in Britain, where we have a democracy that's been set up for many hundreds of years, and you, in a way, are offering something which is somewhat different. You're asking for a random selection process, which sounds plausible. But then, what happens to democracy? Because as British Muslims, should we not really have representation in Parliament, in Council, in European Parliament, at an equal footing and to the same process that our indigenous
democracy has a number of good points and bad points.
But we don't seem to have that democracy amongst the Muslim community.
Yes, we don't, but it's an issue really. I mean, the thing that determines democracy is the money that pays for the campaigns and all of this organisation. Almost all, in fact, I know the last political election, although the Liberal Democrats tried not to be this way, they were, they all accepted million plus million pound donations from big businesses.
Right.
Who did? All the major political parties.
Yes.
The Liberal Democrats tried to say, we're just in our interest in our own small donations, but they actually took a £2.4 million single donation from...
I was not confirming that they laid back your Conservatives.
Yeah, but he was just doing it to even the scale, if you argue. But still, the point is,
we are not saying that money drives...
You're saying one of the party got
its millions, then. In comparison, what did, let's say, the Labour Party get the government?
Yeah, that's the point, but it's driven by money.
It's
a random sample.
Yeah.
It's not on the pockets of big business. It's
right.
Actually the real world of the
random processing selections.
I can suggest another easier way to put the man's proposal.
Mm-hmm.
Just open up the Muslim directory.
Sorry?
Just open up the Muslim directory. You'll find a lot of organisations that have been well established over a number of years, much smaller. They don't have the money and the media penetration, but they're doing a lot of good work on the ground. And I think if we just get a selection of the positive examples of work that are taking place up and down the country, people who are in touch with the people that they serve. I mean, we, you know, like I said, MCB are doing a certain amount of work at a certain level. It's London-centric. The numerous organisations that are working, localised organisations that are working, Birmingham, in Bradford, in Manchester, even, up and down the country, people
who are... none of them have seemed to make their way into
the story. We're talking about women's
panel that had a meeting with the people.
Yeah, I mean, for example, women-led organisations like the Anisar Society, it's a pioneering organisation, it's been working for over 20 years, but you'd rarely hear about it. They've got very articulate spokeswomen who can talk about the work that they do. The Muslim Women's Helpline. There's numerous organisations that are working on the ground, and they need to be given the space to be known as well. I think once we start seeing those different voices, then we're going to get a truly democratic reflection of the diversity in the Muslim community.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I just want to add on to what Sadiq has actually mentioned. You talk about the Muslim representation, democracy, random selection. One way you can actually get a true representation of the Muslim community is to involve all the various organisations, the mosque, and other cultural organisations that actually reflect some sections of the Muslim community. And then obviously you've got the other social groups, like for example the Muslim Women's Helpline, various institutions. So there actually is representation. But I think even within that, you will still not get much representation of the women. Why? Because women, the Muslim community, the women, they're still far behind in terms of a voice within the community.
Why are they far behind? I mean, you've got so many organisations. You mentioned NISA. We've got people like yourself who are trainers, who are obviously professionals.
Yeah.
So why are women so far behind? I mean, times have moved on. You've got second, third generation now.
Yes. From my experience as a Muslim woman, and obviously as an academic as well, and obviously someone who spent time training various organisations, I think one of the main reasons is that there's a clear disparity between what actually Islam said when you go back to the original sources and how that's actually been interpreted over the years. And you mentioned earlier about re-examining the Sharia. Yes, we should re-examine the Sharia. Let's open up the debate. Let's look at the discussion. Let's look at the Muslim women. Let's look at Muslims in Britain. What are the issues? Let's separate the beliefs from the social and cultural practices and how Islam should be lived in today's 21st century.
Well, that article was in the Irish Times that here it says feminists may force Islamic law rethink academic. Now, I'm sure many of the mosques that you mentioned and your organisation you mentioned and the imams would be curling up reading this. Now, on the average perspective of, let's say, the elders, they would really shrink away from this. They would think this is an attack on Islam and an attack on the Quran and its translations or its understanding. But yet you feel that there seems to be some gravity in this.
Yes, I think basically you speak about going back to the true Islam, the original Islam. There's no original Islam further apart from going back to the early prophetic time when the Quran has been revealed and the prophet example was actually showing on in reality how to actually live Islam. That actually is the model for Muslim. That is actually the core.
The
Muslim
today would say that's what we're doing.
Yes,
we are doing according to.
But if you go back, if you trace back the history of the Muslim communities from the time of the Prophet to the Abbasids, to the Mughals, to the Ottomans, we actually see a very strong cultural flavor to what is actually Islam is. So what the kind of Islam that we have today is actually more of a cultural flavor than a truly a prophetic society. Because if we go back at the time of the Prophet, there wasn't any spatial differentiation between the role of men and women as such. They were accepted as women. Yes, we give birth to children. They can equally interact politically, socially, economically. They play an active role in the implementation of Sharia, in the giving of Sharia. The wives of the Prophet, after his death, they were the main givers of hadiths and fatwas. Yeah. They were consulted. They were actually the home of Sharia.
What's happened? What's gone wrong? I mean, according to the West, according to the reports that we're picking up, that women are oppressed, they may be forced to wear the hijab, and the understanding of Quran today is, according to what's written, it's oppressive.
The Quran itself is not oppressive, but the interpretation because of the cultural environment.
So you're saying that culture has digressed from the original.
Basically, it has digressed. Basically, wherever we have actually moved, whether it is the under the Persian dynasty, the Sassanid Empire, and all the others that came into being later on, and adopting the Byzantine customs, have actually stifled the learning knowledge in Islam. We need to encourage more female scholarship.
So in a way, we've moved into communities. We would say we've moved into ignorance. Can I bring Sadiq in because we're coming to the end of the program, and maybe you would like to sum up. As well,
just adding on to what the sister said, I think we have to also take into consideration the historical factor of male bias.
Yes.
In terms of, because back into the early days, there were a lot of female scholars around.
Yes.
Many, many, many thousands. I mean, and this is something that needs to be rediscovered, and Muslim men need to know about this. But the fact is, long story short, males have dominated the interpretation of Islam, and that's due to historical reasons that the sisters alluded to, and that's one of the reasons why we have a kind of a very weighted interpretation that is patriarchal. So this is something we have to understand, it's because it's absorbed into different societies that are patriarchal societies, and they have continued that kind of
situation. One of the key factors in this, I think, has to be the professionalisation of Islamic scholarship. In the early days of Islamic scholarship, scholars would absolutely point blank refuse to be paid for anything they did. And now we have professional posts and institutions, and it became a professional activity, funded by WAFs, yes, from the charitable donations, but still a profession. And as a man, has the responsibility to provide for his family, it became a means of provision. And so you have things like this coming in. Just to give an illustration of, not that particular, but of the way it's changed, in the time of the Abbasids, good 100 and something years after the Prophet,
that men are seeking fatwas, are seeking rulings, can we pray behind women because they're filling the mosque? Right? Now, if you go to Leicester, for example, you'll find out of the, whatever, how many mosques they have there, 50 mosques, you'll be lucky if you find one or two where women are even allowed in.
That's a question.
I mean, there's some real reform needed there. Just to go back to the example of the Prophet, where the women were absolutely in the mosque, and if they thought it was better to get home, they wouldn't have been there.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, thank you very much. We've come to the end of the program. We've run out of time. I'd like to thank my guests here. I'd like to thank the audience as well, the viewers who are watching the program today. A very interesting program, I must say. So, what is the future? What I understand from here, yes, we do need organizations to some degree to represent Muslim communities. But at the same time, Muslims need to engage in mainstream politics. Women need to, scholars need to relook at the scripts and translate them according to the scripts and to the Sunnah and not to cultural diversity. Once again, thank you very much for the program, the week today, and hope to see you next week. Until next time.